Hello, and for the first time in a very long while, welcome back to my channel. Today, Apollo is going to tell you all about mountaineering. What do you have to say, Mr. Bubs? I think he's camera shy. Seriously, welcome back to my channel. It has been so long, and I don't have anything to say other than this year was a shit show last year by the time you're watching this. I think that's true for many of us. A lot of really bad things happened that made it so that I was not able to post content for a long time. I'm not going to get into it here. There is a video on my Patreon if you're really interested in what happened, but most of my personal content is not going to be going here from now on. There will be some stuff still going up, but the majority of that is going to be going on my Patreon, and this is going to be where I focus on mountaineering and climbing because that's what I'm passionate about and that's what I know y'all are here to learn about. So today, for my first video back, we're going to be talking about the third tallest mountain in the world, Kanchenjunga, coming in at 8,586 meters or 28,169 feet. That does go into the death zone for those of you who are wondering. You're probably not. Kanchenjunga has a very interesting and controversial history, including historical figures that if you're not familiar with mountaineering history, you might not expect to see, such as Aleister Crowley. The 1905 expedition that he was a part of, one of the earliest expeditions to the mountain, is still shrouded in controversy and confusion to this day. Controversy. 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 There's a lot of history of this mountain that we're going to get into in the future, but today we're going to talk about the first known successful summit of the mountain in 1955. I posted a poll back on Instagram a while ago asking what you wanted to see as your first mountaineering video in months, and it was a very close call, but ultimately y'all wanted to hear about a successful historic mountaineering climb, and I think that this is a great one. As usual, I'm going to be reading off of a script for this so that I get all my details accurate. I try to be as respectful as possible in the pronunciation of names and places and such, but it's not always easy to find those things, especially when it's historical stuff. So if I mispronounce anything, that's absolutely not intended to be out of disrespect. And yeah, if it looks like I'm reading off of something, I absolutely am, because I want to make sure that I get my details as accurate as possible and I'm not just going on a long-winded, rambly rant that makes no sense and you ultimately miss half of the important information, because that's what would happen if I didn't have a script. The first time that Europeans scouted Kanchenjunga for a climbing route was in 1899 by a man named Freshfield. And there had been multiple expeditions. Wait, why did I never look up his first name? Douglas Freshfield. Okay, now I know his name. So the first time that Europeans scouted Kanchenjunga for a climbing route was in 1899 by a man named Douglas Freshfield, and there had been multiple expeditions since then attempting to reach the summit. In 1953, on an expedition to climb the nearby mountain Kabru in the Yalung Valley, John Kempe and Gilmore Lewis believe they saw a potential route up Kanchenjunga. They returned the next year with four additional climbers to scout a route, and their report led to the Alpine Club creating the Kanchenjunga Committee, run by Sir John Hunt, who had led the successful 1903 expedition to Sagar Matha, commonly known as Everest. The Duke of Edinburgh agreed to be the expedition's patron, and the Royal Geographic Society joined as well. This team was led by a man named Dr. Charles Evans. Based on previous climbs and scouting of the mountain, Evans' team planned to climb a route along the southwest Yalung face. Kanchenjunga, which means the five treasures of the snow, has five peaks, five different summits, the tallest of which is at 8,586 meters. This is the true summit, and also is seen as the home place of the gods of the mountain. The summit is sacred to the Sikkim people of India. For this reason, the team had to get express permission to climb the mountain for the first time. They were allowed to only under the conditions that they disturb the summit area as little as possible and that they stop as short of the true summit as they're able to, as it was the home of the gods. I read in a book a few years ago that some see it as the head of a god as well, but in doing research for this video, I only saw it ever referred to as the home of the gods. So I don't know which is the true belief or if it is both, but either way, it's an incredibly holy site. The climbers were asked to only go as far as was necessary to see that the true summit was able to be stood on, that the mountain could be climbed fully, but not stand on the true summit. That is a tradition that continued until recent years when disrespectful climbers decided that their claim of a summit mattered more than respecting the people who live with and worship this mountain. In 2000, the mountain was closed to all mountaineering by the Sikkim in order to protect it. Now it can only be climbed by the Nepalese sides. There are no Indian permits given out. Climbers are still asked not to stand on the true summit. This 1955 climb is historic not only because it was the first summit of this mountain, but because traditional convention was broken on this climb. Climbing had thus far mostly been for scholars, scientists, and enthusiasts who could afford it. But on this expedition, for the first time, a working-class climber, Joe Brown, was invited to join the British expedition. He'd never been to the Himalayas before and was making a name for himself instead in rock climbing, despite being called simply a weekend climber. In 1954, he had set records in the Alps on the west face of the Drew and the west face of the Blaitiere, with with Don Willens, the youngest member of the team. He was joined by 8 other Western climbers. Dr. Charles Evans, a surgeon from Liverpool, was the expedition leader. He had been the deputy leader on the successful 1953 Sagarmatha expedition. He was also in charge of the cinematography and can be thanked for the extensive video footage we have of this climb. He wrote all the dispatches home and out to the Times so that everyone knew how the expedition was going, and he was in charge of the expedition's finances. George Band had been on the 1953 Sagarmatha expedition with Charles Evans, which is how he was chosen for this expedition. He had also climbed on Rokoposhi. He didn't have a ton of Himalayan experience, but he was an experienced cook, so he was in charge of the food for the expedition. Norman Hardy was a civil engineer and had been a part of Sir Edmund Hillary's expedition to the Barun Valley in 1954, where he had made a name for himself, and he was known to be a skilled ice climber. He'd been appointed second in command or deputy of the Kanchenjunga climb, which others felt he had thoroughly earned. Neil Mather, a textile technologist from Manchester, was also new to the Himalayas, although he had years of experience on alpine snow and ice climbs. He was seen as a snow and ice specialist, which made him an asset on this expedition. Dr. John Clegg was an all-around alpine climber and anatomist at Liverpool University who served as the party's physician. John Jackson, a school teacher from Yorkshire, had climbed in the Himalayas for years, and he had plenty of experience, including hunting for the abominable snowman. Fun fact, his brother was one of the 6 climbers that had been on Kempe's excursion to scout Kanchenjunga the previous year. Tony Strether, a captain in the army, had already made quite a name for himself in mountaineering. He had been transport officer for the Norwegian Tirich Mir expedition in 1950, and in 1953 had been a part of the infamous American Chagori expedition, commonly known as K2, in which the entire climbing party nearly fell off the mountain, being saved in the legendary belay by Pete Schoenig. I honestly didn't realize until I was working on this video that I never actually made a video about that expedition. I only ever talked about that on TikTok, and I can't believe I haven't made a video about that, so that is definitely coming in the very near future. Tony had said that until the end of that expedition, he still saw himself as a mere transport officer. It wasn't until he came home and saw his name in international headlines everywhere that he realized that he was now highly regarded as a mountaineer. And finally, a Glaswegian pharmacist named Tom McKinnon was the oldest and most experienced in the party. He had a long climbing history in the Himalayas and was known for making calculated decisions. He also did the still photography for the expedition and is the reason we have any photos at all to look back on. He was said to have spent time agonizing over the combination of cameras, lenses, and filters he would need in order to capture the perfect fleeting photograph. He was very dedicated to his craft, even in extremes. In addition to the 9 Western climbers, there were about 15 climbing Sherpas and 15 Sherpas to be base camp porters. They also brought with them more than 300 local men from Darjeeling to guide them on the 10-day trek to the Yalung Valley. The Sirdar, or head Sherpa of the Kanchenjunga expedition, was Dawa Tenzing, who was an incredible mountaineer who'd made a name for himself on the 1953 Sagarmatha expedition when he carried 2 loads up to the South Col, the entry into the death zone, without oxygen. He was also reportedly so strong in the mountains that he had to be put in front to break trail and laden down with packs so that the team could keep up with him chugging his way up the mountain, and he was still too fast for anyone. He was highly revered by many, even called the King of the Sherpas by Swiss climbers, and he had picked nearly all of the Sherpas that were on the Kanchenjunga expedition, which was clearly a relief to Charles Evans at the very least. A Sherpa named Anulu was chosen as Dawa's deputy. I haven't been able to find the recorded names of all the Sherpas on this climb, and details are often fuzzy about who was on the mountain at what time. It's one of the frustrating things about researching historic and even often modern climbs. Sherpas are never given the recognition that they deserve, and they're often referred to as just my Sherpa or the Sherpa. However, anywhere possible, I've included the names of specific Sherpas who were on this expedition. I've had to cut it together from a bunch of different resources, so I can't say that it's 100% accurate, but based on reading different people's timelines and what was going on, I'm pretty sure I've put together the correct names to the correct Sherpas. Apparently, the 300 men who were carrying their packs were only being paid 4 rupees a day, which was seen as generous by the climbers. I did the math, and at that time, that equated to $1 per day. By modern standards, that's $10 a day for these men to carry these massive loads over 100 miles on foot to base camp. Payment of porters and Western climbers taking advantage of them is absolutely something we'll be getting into in the future. I've been compiling research over time to do a really in-depth Sherpa video all at once. So when they arrived at base camp, they began planning their acclimatization rotation. If you aren't familiar with these climbs, anytime you're climbing high in the mountains, you have to acclimatize to having less oxygen available to you. Failure to acclimatize leads to a whole host of illnesses that can kill you quickly. So on 8,000 meter mountains in particular, it's important that teams spend several weeks climbing smaller nearby peaks and climbing up and down on the mountain that they're trying to summit in order to teach their body to function at higher and higher altitudes. They began their official climb on April 18th, trying to find a way up the Yalung face. space. They ultimately wanted to reach an area they called the Great Shelf, well above the ice falls, where they could explore toward the summit. Nobody had ever been known to have climbed that high on Kanchenjunga. After 3 days of difficult climbing and disappointment, Norman Hardy and George Banff had found a way to about 20,000 feet, but the route was unstable and unsafe. Charles Evans acknowledged that they might have taken the risk if it only had to be done a few times, but when they knew that their climbing Sherpas would be using the route daily for weeks, they couldn't justify that risk. They were at this point in an area called the Lower Icefall, and ice falls are notoriously dangerous. I think the name itself lends you some idea. If you're familiar with the notorious and dangerous Khumbu Icefall on Sagarmatha, just know that George Banff was quoted as saying that this icefall made the Khumbu Icefall look like a children's playground. They also had to stay away from the left bank of the glacier while climbing, where avalanches regularly rain down from Ta Lung Peak, one of the five summits of the mountain. Fortunately, they saw a snow gully up at the top of the western rock buttress ahead of them, which they also called the Hump, and believed that if they could get to that point, they could bypass the icefall and move on to what is called the Plateau, ready to move toward the upper icefall. There are a lot of pictures from this expedition that were published in journals and articles that I've included in the links below that have been asked not to be shared elsewhere, so if you'd like to see what these areas actually looked like, check out the links in the description. There are over 200 photos from this expedition, and I would give so freaking much to have access to all of them, but I'm really grateful for what we do have access to. Over the next 10 days, they move their base camp up. On April 26th, they move Camp 1 two-thirds of the way up the slope of the Western Rock Buttress, and finally on April 28th, after crossing the Hump, they were able to pitch Camp 2 on the plateau, safely above the Lower Icefall. Or as safe as you can get on these mountains. They had faced many dangers. Avalanches, crevasses, almost walking off the mountain trying to find a place to pee. Apparently, there was a morning where George Band sat at base camp and counted the avalanches that they could hear going off around them. Apparently, he had counted off 48 avalanches over the period of the day, and since he said he slept for about a third of that time and wasn't counting, he did the math and came to the conclusion that avalanches were coming down about every 20 minutes. But at Camp 2, the upper icefall above them was rounded, so the avalanches would fall on either side of them rather than directly on top of their camp. Charles Evans details how the chain of camps and supplies that they were creating helped them navigate the mountain better and recognize when changes or repairs needed to be made to the route. Essentially, as people were climbing further up the mountain establishing new routes and camps, other climbers and Sherpas could be resting at the lower camps and climbing in between them in order to stock them properly. When the reconnaissance team would return to the lower camp, they'd have everything they need to take care of themselves and continue. And in continually climbing the routes over and over again, they were able to maintain them by breaking trail after fresh snow, repairing steps, and replacing ladders that served as snow and ice bridges. It took about 2 weeks to properly stock the camp so that they felt ready to continue up to the highest camps. By May 13th, they'd reached about 25,300 feet, 7,700 meters, which they called the upper end of the Great Shelf. This was where they planned Camp 5 and started preparing for the summit climb. On this day, they used their only two closed-circuit oxygen systems as Charles Evans and Norman Hardy went on a lightning reconnaissance mission to scout a spot for Camp 6 in the final summit push. They had open-air systems that they were using for the rest of the high-altitude part of the climb that allowed climbers to breathe a mix of bottled oxygen and fresh air. This was the only time that completely closed circuits were used on the mountain. The previous day, Sherpas Anulu and Erkian had helped them carry their loads to prepare for this. Here, I'm going to read an excerpt from the AAC article that Charles Evans wrote. I don't think that there's any way I could write or reword their summit push that would make any better sense than how he put it, but I am including the names of Sherpas that he didn't include where possible. Jackson and McKinnon, with 11 Sherpas, would first stalk Camp 5. One day behind them, the first summit pair, George Band and Joe Brown, would follow with Neil Mather, me, Dawa Tenzing, and three other Sherpas, Ong Noru, Ong Temba, and Tashi. We would put Camp 6 as near 27,000 feet as possible and leave Band and Brown there to try the next day the final ridge. One or two days behind us, the second summit pair, Norman Hardy and Tony Strether, would follow with two more Sherpas, Erkian and Ila Tenzing, either to repeat the first pair's climb if successful, or if they were unsuccessful, to profit by their experience. While the two summit pairs made these highest climbs, Dawa Tenzing and I would stay at Camp 5. There we could support the climbers above and be a link between them and those below. On May 19th, they began the summit plan with some adjustments. John Jackson had become snowblind, but insisted on continuing on anyway. Snowblindness, if you don't know, is essentially UV rays burning your eyes. It's basically a sunburn for your eyes. It causes pain, discomfort, reduced vision, swelling, and in extreme cases, vision loss. It usually heals on its own in a few days, but is an intense situation to be in while still high on the mountain. For some reason, even in this condition, Jackson was convinced that he could be an asset to the Sherpas if he were to climb with them. He thought that he could just be moral support, even though they were going to have to physically support his climb. He was roped between Sherpas for additional safety and went with Tom McKinnon to climb from Camp 3 to Camp 5. They stayed the night at Camp 4, where Jackson's snowblindness worsened, and the next day, the Sherpas had to take his loads out for him, but they were too heavy for such a high altitude with fresh snowfall. By 4 p.m., 5 of the 9 Sherpas heading to Camp 5 had arrived and set up camp. The other 4 had to drop their loads on the way and head back down to Camp 4. George Band's team planned to grab that gear and head to Camp 5, where they would stay the next day. But that night, a blizzard whipped through. Jackson, McKinnon, and Sherpa Pemba Dorje joined Camp 4, where 4 Sherpas and 4 climbers were already hunkered down. The blizzard lasted a total of 60 hours. Details are a bit fuzzy, but from what I can gather, through the 20th and 21st, they had to stay in their tents, waiting out the storm and huddling for warmth. Late in the afternoon on the second day, the storm calmed enough for McKinnon, Jackson, and Pemba Dorje to descend to Camp 3, but moving up was out of the question. The morning of the 22nd, George Band, Joe Brown, Neil Mather, Charles Evans, Dawa Tenzing, Tashi, Ang Temba, and Ang Noru, who had continued to wait out the blizzard, finally made their way to Camp 5. On the way, they saw that avalanches had swept away some of the supplies they had planned on grabbing, including extra oxygen tanks, which meant that Norman Hardy and Tony Strether were going to have to bring their own 2 days later, adding 24 pounds to each of their packs that they hadn't planned to carry. The avalanche had also scattered the entire camp across the slope. They found and gathered what they were able to and arrived at the campsite, where only the tip of a buried tent was visible under avalanche debris. It was 4:15 p.m., dark already and cold, with icicles forming on their facial hair. Over the next 2 hours, they dug for their buried equipment and battled to pitch a new tent. The next morning, they radioed Hardy and Strether that they had to push the summit plan back a day because they could not continue to the summit today. They had to rest. On May 24th, they continued on toward the site where they would set up Camp 6. As they went, they were running out of oxygen one by one, but they continued on. At Camp 6, the other climbers retreated, leaving George Band and Joe Brown to set up camp at 26,900 feet, well into the death zone, and only 1,200 feet from the summit. Their camp was set on a narrow ledge at the top of an area called the Gang Way. The outer edge of their tent overhung the 45-degree slope they were on by 6 inches. Apparently, Band and Brown secured themselves by tying a rope around their waist, anchored to a spike of rock outside of the tent, wearing all of their gear so as not to freeze in the night, and they settled in for extremely restless sleep. I just want to take a moment and say that this is part of why I admire the fuck out of mountaineers. I know some people think that this is just absolutely ludicrous and they can't justify it in any way, but I'm just like, these people survive in extremes on no sleep and little food and still keep pushing through and accomplishing just like really incredible things. You know what most people would be doing if they spent the entire night anchored to a rock so that they didn't get blown off a mountain to their icy and or rocky deaths? Crying and going home, not continuing to climb the mountain on no sleep and tense muscles. Yet that's exactly what they did, starting at 8 o'clock the morning of the 25th. They grabbed new oxygen and made their way up the gangway, inching their way to the summit on a somewhat mixed route of rock, snow, and ice. In attempting to find the right route, they diverted onto the southwest face too early and weren't able to continue on the steep, rocky terrain. They had to descend and then climb back up via another route, a mistake which cost them an hour and a half. By the time they reached the west ridge, about 300 feet below the summit, it was already 2 in the afternoon, which was late by their standards, but very late by modern 8,000er climbing standards. It's pretty well known in modern mountaineering that a safe summit on a mountain like this usually has to happen by noon or you need to turn around. A lot of disasters and deaths have happened when people have pushed to the summit too late in the day and got caught in bad weather. But it really makes you think when you go back historically and people were able to make safe summits later in the day, how much of this can be attributed to climate change? Anyway, Band and Brown took a short rest, enjoying lemonade, toffee, and mint cake to refresh themselves, and then they continued. They had a self-imposed turnaround time of 3 p.m. if they hadn't reached the summit, but in less than an hour, they had made the final trek up to the summit slope. By 2:45 p.m., they stood only 5 feet away. They say that they didn't even intend to come that close to the summit, but they weren't sure where exactly it was until they were almost on top of it. However, honoring their promise to the Sikkimese people, they didn't step on the true summit of the mountain. It was there. The mountain could be climbed. It could be summited. They started their descent and ran out of oxygen again only an hour in. They intended to descend to Camp 5 to get out of the death zone, but Joe Brown had momentarily removed his goggles and realized he was snowblind, and it wasn't safe to continue on. They only made it down to Camp 6, still in the death zone, and on that precarious ledge where they crammed in to share the tent with Norman Hardy and Tony Strether, who were preparing to summit the next day. On the 26th, Hardy and Strether found a slightly different route and also summited without standing on the true summit of the mountain. On other mountains, you have to stand on the true summit in order to claim that you've summited. But on Kanchenjunga, it's always been honored as summiting if you get within a few yards and respect the Sikkimese people. As soon as they summited, everyone started retreating down the mountain, knowing that the monsoon would hit in just a few days. By May 28th, the entire climbing party had made it back down to base camp. When they reached base camp, they were saddened to learn that Pempa Dorje had died of altitude sickness. Altitude sickness is still a major concerning contributor to death in the mountains, but nowadays we can recognize it a bit sooner and have things that could help combat it at least a little bit. At that time, there was nothing. Altitude sickness was almost certainly deadly. This climb marked the seventh of the 8,000 meter mountains to be successfully summited. All 14 of the 8,000ers were summited between 1950 and 1964, and every time one of these mountains was summited for the first time, it inspired hope and lit a fire in mountaineers around the world to continue to climb these peaks. There are so many reasons to climb just beyond reaching the highest mountains. There are so many climbs that are much harder than any 8,000 meter mountain because they're much more dangerous and technical, even if they're smaller. Climbing is absolutely not just about reaching the highest of highs, but it is a motivation for many, and reaching these peaks for the very first time was a major motivator for over 100 years. This particular summit had been recorded as being in the minds of explorers as early as 1882. But I think something really interesting is a quote from Joe Brown about reaching the summit after all this time. "I didn't feel like I'd conquered a mountain. I don't know why people use the word conquered. It's such a stupid word. You never conquer a mountain. You either reach the top if you're lucky, or if the weather's bad, you've had it. When I reached the summit, my overwhelming feeling was relief that I didn't have to keep going up." In this video, I condensed down a lot of the technical details of the climb, such as equipment used and specific breakdowns of areas of the mountain, because I know that's just too much information for a lot of people. But if you want to read full detailed accounts of the climb from members of the expedition, I've included links below. There's a lot of interesting information about the equipment that was being used for the expedition, because at that time, there were still massive strides being made in new climbing technology as climbers figured out better ways to suit their needs. All these links are either references used for the video or interesting extra tidbits of information. There's an American Alpine Club publication written by Charles Evans and an Archive Sports Illustrated article from 1955 written by George Band, which allows you to virtually flip through the magazine and has pictures from the expedition. There's an American Alpine Club publication from George Band detailing the climb, and my favorite, a 107-minute free video of footage from the actual expedition. It's silent, no interviews or anything, but it's so freaking fascinating to watch. It is location locked to the UK, so you'll either need to be UK-based or use a VPN based in the UK to watch it. I've also included an early article by Douglas Seid going over some of the earliest history of Westerners exploring Kanchenjunga, and a link that goes over the history of Kanchenjunga climbs up until 2004. It's obviously out of date, but it still has a lot of good information if you want a basic overview or names and information to look up so you can learn about some of these climbs before I get the videos out. I will say that because these are publications by white men from years ago, there is definitely racism, incorrect terms, slurs, and other prejudice that's included in these articles. It sucks, but it's important to recognize. Mountaineering's always been fraught with racism and a domineering attitude, which continues until now and is part of what we'll be delving into in future videos. So be aware and cautious if necessary, and take what they have to say with a grain of salt. Thank you so much for being here. I hope you enjoyed this video and that you learned something. A huge thank you to my patrons for supporting this work and supporting me doing what I love. This is so much work. It is so intense and I love it, but I also love getting paid for my work, as I'm sure most humans being do. So, did I say humans being? Human beings. If you'd like to support my work and get early access to all of my mountaineering videos, as well as extra personal content, please consider joining my Patreon, which is also linked below. Have a wonderful day, drink some water, and please pretend I have a better sign off than this.